mashups are pretty tricky to design, actually. Can you think of a game where the shops just don't become like a place to pawn all the junk you get from the monsters in the game? I mean, there's a couple of examples, but they're hard to come by. Again, as usual, I really love NetHack, and I think NetHack does a pretty bang job of presenting the player with a lot of opportunities with shops, whether it's a protection racket or price identifying items or stealing stuff. Shops have a lot of possibilities. Of course, before I can even get to that point, I need the basic concept of buying and selling stuff. Just wanted to quickly mention that my game Solar Rogue is already available in early access on Steam and itch.io and Android and iOS. So if you want to check it out and make a purchase or leave a comment or some feedback, that's really appreciated. It really helps me and it helps my development and it helps create great contents for you guys. So, shops. Well, that's a little bit vague, so the first thing I had to do was kind of expand the idea a little bit. From the beginning, when I started working on Solar Rogue, I knew I wanted one of the branches to be similar to the Gnomish Mine in NetHack, with the third level being some kind of mine town. So in my case, I wanted the third level to be the Human Coalition, where it would be the only neutral area in the game where you're guaranteed to get a bunch of shops and traders where you can finally find some items for the deeper level of the game where things get a little bit more difficult. One of the things I knew I wanted is the shops had to be some kind of ship and they had to be destroyable. They had to be real entities. I don't want invulnerable ships, which means I needed them to be able to fight back, and I wanted to have some kind of protection, some maybe police that if you do something illegal will come and hunt you down. I knew that shops had to be very obvious. I wanted the player to right away know that this is something different. So I had to brainstorm a lot of ideas on how I was going to show this to the player. I also knew that I wanted the shops to have some kind of specialty, like this is a weapon trader, or this is a utility trader, or this is a ship trader or something. So I had to design the code to take this into account. And finally, I had to decide how I was going to price my item, not only what kind of currency I was going to use, but also, like, are the prices randomized by item, by shops, by run? These are all things I had to consider. Once I had the requirements a bit more nailed down, it was time to start implementing the visual and the general user experience. Because I think I've said it in like my last 10 videos, but I'm the kind of programmer who likes to start from the top and dig my way down. So I like to start with the user experience and then see if I can somehow manage to fit the code to work with the top layer. Sometimes it makes the code a little bit harder to implement, but I think it's always possible to fix it later, where fixing a bad user interface can sometimes be a little bit difficult. The first thing that I had the most trouble with was figuring out a way to present the player with the shopping experience. How will the player know that this is a shop and that he can interact with it? And how is he going to interact with it? I wanted something really, really obvious and something really clear. At first I was thinking maybe I can change the outline. I already have like blue outlines, red outlines, and white outline. I thought maybe I can do like a green outline for trading ship. But I thought this wasn't quite obvious enough. Then I thought maybe I can put some icon somewhere, and I kind of like the idea because it looks a little bit like somewhere you can dock with the other ship and you can establish some trading communication or something. I even added a little message when you fly over one of the trading ports so that it's clear what you have to do to open the trading interface. And I think it's really nice and clean, and this way I feel it's not even necessary to have like a tutorial prompt explaining what trading is or something. Like, it's obvious when you see it, you want to fly over it, and when you fly over it, you get a message telling you, well, you need to open com to open trading. So I think this is a much more natural experience than if I had done some kind of forced tutorial or tutorial prompt or something. The next part was, of course, designing the menu for this trading. And this was not so complicated because I already have a way of exchanging items between ships. So this was basically just the same thing, but instead of just exchanging for free, well, you have to pay some amount of energy or something. One of the things I wasn't so sure about doing is how I was going to present the information of what you're going to trade. I wanted something in the middle that will tell you information about the item you want to purchase or the item you want to sell. And I had to come up with a bit of a design, and I thought this kind of card-like design was very interesting. They're basically just scroll container with a couple of buttons, and the visuals is always a 9-patch rec that I use for all my other user interface that I saved already in a scene that does all of this for me. Now that I had a pretty good idea of the use cases for my trading system, I could start thinking about the actual implementation. And most of my game is following the same architecture. You see, all the data I need for generating the levels and the ships and the items are all stored inside JSONs, arrays, and dictionaries. And the way it works is that each dictionary key is basically like something I call a component. And so I took one of the ships I already had, I copied it, and I added this new merchant component, which is just another dictionary inside my JSON file, and I started adding the information specific to the merchant, like a weighted list of potential inventory and information about where to position the trading port inside the UI. And once I have all this data, what I like to do usually is that I have these basic nodes in my main scene that I call behaviors, and they have a script attached to them that will just handle all this data for all the items in the game. It doesn't mean that each component necessarily has a behavior attached to it. Sometimes one behavior manipulates multiple components, or sometimes a component is used in multiple behaviors. But in this case, I thought that having a merchant behavior that would be responsible for generating the inventory based on the data and would also manage creating the trade ports and the icons and managing the position of the icon and all that would make sense. These trade port created a few interesting issues in my game because they're kind of slave to the ships, but they're also their own entity, so I had to somehow make them work together. And that's where the behavior structure becomes really nice. Because, for example, when the merchant moves, I need to move the trade port. But the movement behavior doesn't need to care about the trade port, because when the ship moves, all it needs to do is send an event on my event bus that will tell everyone that this ship has moved. And then it's the merchant's behavior responsibility to make sure that the trade port is following the merchant. Now, to hook up my mockup of the UI to actual code was actually pretty easy, because in the end, all I'm doing is transferring item from one ship to another and transferring energies from one ship to another, and I already have plenty of events for dealing with this kind of stuff. So it was just plugging in the events at the right place, following the right trigger from the buttons in the UI. And with just that, I already had the basic loop working for my game. But, of course, that was just like 20% of the work. The whole 80% of polishing everything was the big part. And this meant, for example, adding a new AI that would react to illegal actions. But that was fairly easy because I already have an easy way to switch my AI inside my code. So I just created this new behavior and plugged it in my kind of state machine, and that was this. And then I had to add like sound effects for when you're trading stuff, and I had to make sure that the UI was really polished, that, for example, you can't try to purchase something if you don't have the energy for it, so that the button is grayed out, or that, you know, I change the colors when it's purchasing or selling so that it's really obvious, and, you know, in general, just doing a bunch of bug squashing. In the end, I'm pretty happy with the result. I mean, right now, traders only show up in the human coalition level at the last level of the human branch, but it would be really easy to make them show up a little bit everywhere. And right now, they provide a very interesting piece of gameplay, I think, because going to the human coalition level at the very beginning is a little bit difficult and tricky, but if you do get there, there's a big potential for really awesome item. But at the same time, you need to have the energy to be able to purchase all of those cool items. This was something that was really hard to balance because I had to consider that my game also have crafting and also random drop from enemies. So I had to consider which one is cheaper, and also I didn't want to let the player be able to do some kind of hack where he can craft something and sell it for profit or something. And this is getting a little bit difficult to manage because everything revolves around energy. And so I had to consider how much energy a player spends, for example, crafting something versus how much energy he can spend to buy something, and also that selling something is worth the effort. And to do this, the only way I found was to boot up again Google spreadsheets and try to make a table of the real cost of crafting something versus the cost of buying something or selling something, and try to balance it that way. Because the true cost of crafting is not just the fact that crafting takes energy, but also that it takes resources, that each of those resources are worth a certain amount of energy. But in the end, I think I got something kind of working, but I'm pretty sure I'm gonna have to revisit all of this because I want to add some more features, like maybe the ability to steal from shops, or maybe the ability to buy back things that you've sold, or also the ability to add ships in random parts of the levels, and all of this is going to require a little bit more polishing, but for now I'm really happy with the way it turned out. But all of this is probably going to be for a future update, and for now that's going to be it for this week. So please don't forget to check out Solar Rogue in a digital store near you, and see you all in my next episode. Bye.